Hello and welcome to the Mikey and Me podcast. Welcome back. We hope you're a repeat customer. I'll say that. But if you're not, and you're watching and you're joining us for the first time, I'm Mikey. That's me. His name is Matthew.
Yep.
I just found that out.
Yeah, I finally figured it'd be good to tell him my legal name, because this is season 3 premiere. So
wow.
He said my name before. I never confirmed it, but I whipped out the old driver's license and said, "Mikey, here's the truth." And he's like, "I knew it." I was like, "Yeah, you did." It's that gift of yours. You can tell when a woman's on her period, and you can tell what a person's name is just by looking at them.
Yeah, you can't. There's not much you can get by me. I'll say that.
I don't know anything I can get by you.
Yeah. No, there's really not anything. But yeah, so if you're joining us again, thank you. And if you're watching, you've probably noticed there's something different. And that is...
What is it? There's more than one thing.
We're wearing headphones.
That is
one of the main differences.
It's something...
Aside from the absence...
Yes.
...of our couch guest.
Esteemed couch guest. This is...
No, we pissed him the fuck off, I think.
I think I might have hurt his feelings.
No, neither one of them.
Chris normally calls me every Saturday. He didn't.
They're fucking both gone. They did. They were like...
Yeah, but seriously, Chris normally hits me up every Saturday. He didn't.
Well, why did you think? Did you think about hitting him up whenever he didn't hit you up?
This is our dynamic. It's our relationship.
Oh, that's not... okay, so you're writing it off to the fact that you don't have to call him because... I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, but plus it's literally just been a given that every Saturday when you come over for us to record, he's with you.
Yeah.
So it's almost like we don't even need to touch bases.
But now does a part of you feel bad?
I don't know what to feel.
I feel like maybe a part of you should feel that, like, damn, you know.
I'm not going to project
that on you. You shouldn't.
Maybe I feel like I need to be a better friend or something. Because whenever he showed up alone, I was almost like, well, I'll be damned. Where's Mr. Smith? And you're like, dude said, get the fuck out of here. I don't want to be any part of your little show. I feel like you guys neglect me. You don't want to listen to my insight. I love him and I miss him.
Yeah, well, either way, if you'll notice, we're wearing the headphones.
And he's gone. Yep.
This is his... This was his idea, and he's not here to.
He did mention it a while ago
with us,
and we're like, "Yeah, it's cool." You know, you see other podcasts doing it, and there's a reason, but we're embracing it, and we've already had more fun talking and just hearing our voices than I might have ever had listening to anything in my life.
Yeah, maybe this is fun.
Yeah, we're having a great time. So
what? Do you want to?
But so. There's a pug barking in the background. I don't know if y'all hear that.
No, I don't know if we've quite fulfilled her needs tonight. She wants us to, like, give her more food, I think, or something.
She doesn't like her food. I've been giving her, I've been putting cheese in it, and she's not liking it. She's being all sorts of difficult.
She's starting to rebel.
Yeah, well, I think so. But so, this is the final week and final weekend before the wife and baby are back from their 2-week visit at my sister's, who lives in New Mexico. It's been a strange freedom that, it's obviously, there's a very nice, pleasant aspect, but it is weird I miss my daughter so much, and I just don't let myself think about it, so I don't get set, you know? It's like, not that I'm not thinking about her, but it's... You know, because at first there, I could just think about her and want to start crying. Because I just haven't missed a person like this. And since I was, like I said, I think I might have said before, maybe whenever I was, like, a kid missing my mom. Like, it's just a kind of missing separation anxiety that's just... Like, it's part of the human experience, right? So I'm embracing it. So, but, you know, it's gotten easier. But now I'm excited because they're going to be back tomorrow. And I can just... And I've been video chatting with them a lot. We've really taken advantage of technology, which is awesome with that.
Yeah.
So, like, every day, you know, I video chat with them so she doesn't forget my face.
Yeah, because she might She might forget your face. Your face is forgettable. If I had to mark it under something, it would be forgettable.
Wouldn't be under who gives a
I should silence my phone.
No, actually, why don't you tell us what's going on?
I'm in a group chat of Xbox guys.
Oh yeah, and, they're trying to play a game that you're not.
Well, they all bet. They're a bunch of bettors too.
The gamblers. These guys are, Mikey, well, they can
sports
bet.
And they're part of the United States, but I can't sports bet here, which I feel like I should be able to sports bet. You know, I really do feel like.
I mean, you could skirt it. There's ways you could.
Okay, but yeah, I'd like to not have to skirt things. I'd like to be able to do things legally.
Above board, if you will?
Yeah, above board.
But there are things that you do regularly that are not above board.
I don't think there is, and I'd rather not comment on any of those things.
Okay, that's good.
I don't think that there is, though. But
that's true. So your friends bet, right? So what are they betting on right now?
They're betting on baseball. Baseball is the thing to bet on.
Why?
These guys will, why?
Like, what are these?
Well, it's just baseball season. It's not that it's the thing to bet on.
It's the
on.
Sport that's going on.
Yeah.
They don't bet on basketball?
Oh, they bet on all of it. They're betting on basketball. They're betting on anything. These guys will bet on Korean ping pong at 4:30 in the morning.
Are you being serious?
I am being serious.
So, I mean, if you really do want to bet, you could just give... They're good enough friends to where they could just do it on your behalf, right?
Yeah, if I really wanted to, but I don't know.
It's not appealing. Have you ever been gambling before?
No, I've never been gambling. I've never been to the casinos. I know they're real close.
I've been to Vegas a couple times.
Is it fun?
Gambling for me is a fucking blast.
Is it?
You like it? I like it a lot.
You like gambling?
No, it's not good.
You're like, you take this money.
It's fun.
What's your game of choice?
Oddly enough, roulette.
Roulette. Just a game of chance.
Yep. A game of feeling and intuition that whenever it works, because the best. So it's for my good buddy Hamilton. I guess kind of like a bachelor party getaway with like three or four of us. We wanted to go to Vegas, so we did that. And I just remember one of the days, it was like early in the day, I guess. I just went to the roulette table. I put like maybe $20 chip down. It was black 13. Hit it. And
wow.
I was like, sweet. There's like, you know, $200-$300 or something. And then we're doing whatever throughout the day, and then I was going up to go, you know, get to bed, whatever, but then I was like, one more time, I just want to go to that same table, and I'm like, call black 13 again. Hit it again.
You just feel good about hitting on black 13?
I don't know, that's just what I was compelled to do, and twice in a row, and it was the same person working, they're like, didn't you come here earlier and do that? I'm like, yeah. So, it was like, you know, $700-$800 I just made from doing those. And so I guess, I mean, obviously that makes it easy to say it's my favorite.
Yeah, that really would, yeah.
But it's just feeling into it. I don't know, just something about it, you know, with our whole interest in metaphysical intuition and all this stuff. Whatever it's worth, it's literally just like looking at it and moving the chips around and just seeing what feels right, you know?
Okay, yeah, I get you.
Just like whatever sense it is, which isn't...
Going with your gut.
Yeah, just being like... Yeah.
Yeah, so I definitely want to go to a casino. I've never... There's things I've never done. It's like... I'm 32 and there's a lot of stuff I've never done.
No, well, let's list them all.
No, one thing, I've never gone to a strip club for leisure. I was actually talking about this the other day.
For leisure? Yeah.
I've gone there for work. I didn't work.
You never had to go for like a friend's bachelor thing or something?
No, uh-uh. I went I went when I worked with Specs. I used to deliver liquor to these places, and that was interesting.
You walked in there and snuck a peek at
some
titty?
Oh, it's funny you say this. There was one of these places we delivered to, and it was off of Harry Hines, and it was called Chicas Bonitas.
Pretty girls.
Chicas Bonitas. And on the little thing, it says, like, deliver through side door. And everybody, when I was leaving the warehouse, was just kind of snickering and laughing.
This is whenever you worked with Vito?
Yeah, he did work with me there. Yeah. So I was leaving the warehouse, and guys were kind of snickering and this and that, and I was just like, I don't know why they were looking at me and laughing.
Yeah.
And I later on find out I go to this place, Chicas Bonita, the strip club, and it's like I go through this side door or whatever, and I like turn my back to it because I have the dolly, and I pull the dolly up and push my back against the door, and I open up, and I'm in the women's locker room. Well, where they're all just changing.
Are you serious?
These are all just like large. Nothing against it. I'm not shaming anybody for their body shape, anything like that. But these women,
they were gorda bonitas.
They were jobbers, and
jobber.
Yeah, jobber. Look up jobber in like wrestling terms. What's a jobber? But then not only that, it was just sweaty, man. It was like Andre the Giant just got done wrestling Hulk Hogan, dude. It was just like
a stinky locker room.
When it was sweaty and steamy. It could have been the fog machine from the other room. Nothing was
sexy about it.
No, not at all. But I just walked in and like looked around, and like none of them really even paid attention to me, and I was just
they're so used to being that way in front of people.
Yeah, and not only that, but I realized that like, okay, I'm in the right spot.
So then you started going there every day. So I just looked up jobber, and I don't know. This says jobber is a professional wrestling term used to describe a wrestler who's routinely defeated by main eventers.
Yeah, a jobber. It's just somebody who shows up, and it's like so guys are trying to put over the new like the new pretty face or baby face guy, like say Shawn Michaels is coming up. So you're
just calling them, these are just average women.
Yes.
Basically what you're saying.
Yeah, it's just
ending the movies and then entertainment, they glamorize the reality of strip clubs.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Very uncomfortable.
But either way, places. Like it was just that was a place that I had never gone to for leisure, and I went in there for a job, and it was just like a totally different side of it that I saw.
Yeah, and I saw the underbelly of the beast.
Oh, I did, and I was just like, man, the lights were on back there because out there it's dark, in the strip club.
But back there, the lights were on. A lot of the faults.
Oh, the darkness hid a multitude of sins, so to say.
Yeah. Well, you should go for fun sometime because it's not fun.
I should support them.
I've been with groups of people that, for one reason or another, I ended up at one. I never wanted to go on my own. It would never be my idea. And I would see the dancers and I would literally just feel bad for them.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and then of course, it's their choice. They get there and... But I just feel like, and that's they're doing it. It's not every. I'm sure there's some that it's like a last resort. And of course, like I should, understand and feel bad in those cases. But a lot of them, they know it's good money and they don't mind doing it. So
that's
I really don't need to feel bad for them. But no, I still no. just, I just like I couldn't get any really enjoyment out of it.
Yeah, so needless to say, you won't catch us at strip clubs.
But we might do a remote at the one.
Oh, at a strip club, do a remote podcast?
That might be kinda cool. Against them. We want to talk about why we don't like them, and then they won't let us do it, and then it's a bad idea, so I'm not going to say anything else about it anymore.
Okay, yeah, we can try that.
Strip clubs is great gambling. Gambling is something you do. We can go up to Oklahoma sometime.
Yeah, we'll have to do that.
I've never been to Oklahoma casinos, which...
I haven't either. I've driven past them, and they look nice. Yeah, it is very easy. Yeah,
it's so easy. It's not like a Vegas excursion or it's exhausting. It's literally, we could just take a drive up, have a little fun. Over a
weekend, couple days. Like,
we really should.
Come back, bam, bam.
Like, yeah, day trip. Like, Saturday, come out. I'm serious. That'd be fun.
You think I'm not serious?
I mean, they're open 24/7.
We're just going to go right now.
Yeah.
And this podcast, it took us 2.5 hours to do testing.
No, we'll record on the road.
Oh, okay. Road trip
podcast. Speaking of road, between the road from last episode to this.
Okay, I see.
Not much has happened. We do a quickly weekly catch up, which, it's... Maybe we'll stop doing it, but I'm doing it right now. Next to the wife's and daughter coming back tomorrow. So it's had a lot of freedom. Watched a lot of stuff. I blew through Three Body Problem, the new sci-fi series on Netflix. They have quite a many a thought on. Yeah, Mike, you came over last night, and we had a little sleepover again. It was a lot of fun.
It was a lot of fun.
That was the highlight of the week, you know? It was, and then my dad seen, and they're all highlights, who knows? But, you exposed me to a movie I hadn't seen called Death Sentence from Kevin Bacon, which...
Yeah, man.
In the end, it was... an adrenaline fuel, you know, ride of vengeance.
On the scale of Mothman to 10, what would you rank it? How many? Or on 1 to Mothman, Mothman being the worst, 1 being the best. To really confuse you and the guest audience.
Just maybe a half a prophecy. Mothman.
A half a prophecy.
Yeah.
Okay, we're getting somewhere.
Yeah. So, but you came over, showed me that, and you said you were going to hang out during Saturday, but then you bailed on me to hang out with some old lady around lunch, and then, it's me. What do you got?
Yep, so, yeah, like you said, not much happened between then, just work, trying to catch up on sleep. I feel like this whole week, I've just been kind of going and going and going. I haven't had much time to just kind of chill, but...
So I feel bad making you drive out here, but it's okay. I feel don't like worry. We're chilling that right now.
Yeah.
This is rejuvenating.
Yes, this is very rejuvenating. We're getting to just hang out and chill, which is nice, and I played softball on Friday, and we won. I played bad, though.
I know. You were supposed to hit a home run for me.
And I didn't, man. I didn't. I just kept getting on top of the ball and hitting it into the ground, and I got on base every time.
Remember, I offered you totally for free. I'd be your hitting coach.
I know. You said you were I'll teach you. And
I have I never played baseball well, but I've seen how guys hit the ball. I could give you a solid idea of maybe what might work, and you're missing out.
I have to give it a shot. I think we're probably going to have to give that a shot. But before we give that a shot, what do you say we just go ahead and jump in? Are we going to go ahead and get into these movies?
Yeah,
we left off on...
I'm going to take a quick little break first, but then I think we're coming in on 2004.
I would want to say so, because we've done... Yeah, I'd say
2004. We'll figure that out, and we'll dive right into it, because this is going to be a fun one.
Oh, yeah.
This is going to be...
It's going to be a
freaking blast. Oh, my gosh. We'll be right back. Back from a productive, lovely break.
Oh yeah,
figured some things out. Maybe confused yourself on some other things, but we know what you're here for.
Yeah, we thumb wrestled and I beat him 2 out of 3. That's what really happened. He doesn't want to talk about it, but that's what happened. A lot of people say that they can thumb wrestle, but nobody can really thumb wrestle like me. Let me tell you, these things right here—they're big. These things are big, beefy thumbs, and they will pin you down.
Mr. President, I wasn't blessed with what I would call powerful thumbs, or you know, what I would say, fully functioning thumbs. I can barely get this one to bend. And this other one, I'm pretty sure it fell off.
What a loser. This guy's got little thumbs. I say, what a weak thumb. We call him Little Weak Thumb Matthew. It's okay. That's why you got a guy like me.
Okay, I appreciate it. I'd like to tell you a little bit about films from 2003.
Let's get through these.
Yep. So just a quick hit on there. So... See, Lord of the Rings, Return of the King won Academy Award for Best Picture. Felt like that was really just kind of an award for the whole trilogy. BAFTA Awards for Best Film and Golden Globe. So, yeah, that got a lot. Lost in Translation came out that year. Got Golden Globe for Best Motion Picture, Musical or Comedy. Finding Nemo. Oh, that's your Finding Nemo came out, so... Like every year, you know, we're seeing like, oh yeah, there's a lot of cool popular stuff. But without further ado, A to Z, 2003, we're going to give you a handful of...
A quick little rundown.
Yeah, we think are the best movies from that year. And we've had at least 3 or 4 people on the show before, just 2 of us. I think we should probably pick at least 3 each.
Yeah, why not? Let's pick. And, I'm going to have my phone out here. Well, I guess technically I have these little markers right here that I was scribbling and doodling with.
Yeah. And let's see, and I'll get a little something there. So here we go.
Let's see. Let's go on down the list. What do we got? 11:14. Actually, it's 11:27.
Yep, so no idea. 101 Damnations. 2.
Dalmatians.
Let's see. Ooh.
Yeah, too fast, too furious.
Too furious.
Okay. 21 Grams. I remember seeing this.
Oh, yeah.
I never watched that movie, but I remember seeing the previews for it.
Yeah, it was the whole 21 grams has to do with, I guess, supposedly the amount of weight somebody loses when they die, so it's as though that's the weight of the soul.
Oh.
That's why it's called that.
I gotcha.
Yep. See, 44 Minutes in North Hollywood Shootout. Abby Singer, Afropunk, Agent Cody Banks. You loved Frankie Muniz.
Man, so. I really loved, you gotta love, who didn't love Frankie?
Malcolm in the Middle. I mean, I remember you talking about this movie for months before it came out.
You tell another lie like that again.
I mean, dude, I kind of Cody Banks has a special place. So we got Aileen, Life and Death, Alex Nema, Alien Hunter. American.
Yep, that's the names. He's reading them all.
American Splendor, American Wedding. Those
part anger of that management. That's a good one. That's a good.
So American
one.
Wedding. That's part of the whole, you know, American Pie stuff. Anger Management.
Yeah, American Wedding was a good comedy. I did enjoy it.
Anger Management. It's okay to like it. And be real. Anything else? Badass. Bad Boys 2. You're a fan of the Bad Boys, aren't you?
Yeah, I do enjoy the Bad Boys.
Aren't they making a new one? Like, isn't there another? They're making another sequel. Yeah, I'm pretty sure they are. No, I'm pretty sure they are. Oh man.
Yep.
Bad Santa.
Look at that.
This. Right there. Yeah. This is a landmark. So freaking funny. Just Billy Bob Thornton owns that role so well. And
yeah,
it's just literally what it is, Bad Santa. And it's just the concept. And just Billy Bob is so good at pulling off.
Yeah,
just
if you haven't seen Bad Santa, definitely watch it. But make sure the kids are in bed. It's about a mall Santa.
It's a hard R. Yeah,
but then also, too, it's a... yeah. Also, as well, it's like it's a heist movie in a sense too, but it encapsulates a lot of things. But it's definitely a must watch. Just again, not
it's
with your
so
kids.
So funny.
It's a super rated R
movie.
You
might find it offensive, but you just have to let yourself just embrace the ridiculousness of his character.
Absolutely. But then the next one we got on the list is Basic. What is that? The Battle of what? What does that say? Is that an O or an A?
Shaker Heights.
Shanker? Okay.
Shaker
Heights.
Bells of Innocence, Best 2 Years, Beyond Borders, Big Fish.
Big Fish. That was a
Big Fish is really good.
Love that movie.
My buddy Nathan, you know, the one I've mentioned before.
Yes.
Tried to lost him. Yeah, dude. He was just really... like into the magical
Edward Bloom,
creative.
That was the guy.
You know,
he was in the,
it's like the magical creative, just inspirational type stuff.
I love that.
It was so good. Really, was quite moving. Biker Boys, Black Cadillac, Blind Horizon, Blizzard, Boat Trip, Bring Down the House, Bring in Rain, Brother Bear, Brown Bunny. This, I'm pretty sure I've talked about this movie before, so. Vincent Gallo, the director, who did, I think one movie before this, Buffalo 66, which is, an indie film that, it was whatever, it was, had its moments, you know, but it wasn't anything special. Well, his second film, it's, I guess, unrated. Or whatever rating that allows actual sex. So Chloe, there's a scene in this I feel like defines him, this literally this choice to do this and the doing this defined him in his career to where I don't. So he wrote and directed it, and there's a scene where she actually is giving him fellatio, and it straight up shows it. And
is that the guy from? Wait, were you talking about the movie or a character?
I'm talking about the movie, but in the movie, Chloe 70 actually.
It
actually shows her sucking his.
Oh.
Like, it's real. Like, oh, it's unsimulated. That's the thing that was like NC-17 or unrated. But, and it was. And I had to watch the movie and get to a point. And it's like so pointless. It's
literally. And it's like, why?
Yeah.
Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
It's
what it kind of sounds like. And that's the same guy that directed this movie right here, Brown Bunny?
Yeah, he starred and directed it. And Chloe Sevigny, I feel like the choice to do that hampered her career. I mean, she still has.
Well, I can imagine that, yeah, doing that.
But it's like, it's so. It's ridiculous. It's absurd. Bruce Almighty.
You do it behind closed doors to get the job, that's one thing. But you do it on TV, and that's another.
Yeah, there's. I have to show you the scene later. It'd be great to bring us closer. Bruce Almighty, a bulletproof monk. That's your type of movie.
Yeah, I like Bulletproof Monk. I like Chow Yun-Fat. I like that movie. It was him and
Sean William.
Yep, Sean William Scott. I did enjoy that movie. Let's see, Cat in the Hat with Mike Myers. That was a good one. Charlie's Angels, Full Throttle. That wasn't a bad one. That was okay.
The sequel, MCG, the director. Yeah, he's made his mark doing a lot of music videos.
Okay.
And so it's kind of...
He's a music video guy.
Yeah, but then he's got a... This is a really clear, stylized...
Yeah.
Style that he has. Chasing Pep. Yeah.
Chasing Pep. Cheaper by the Dozen. Christmas Child. Coffee and Cigarettes.
Oh, this was a pretty important... Not important, but it was a pretty popular indie film. Jim Jarmusch, one of his earlier ones. It's not for me.
Cold Creek Manor.
Hmm.
I remember that one being and Cold Mountain. Those are both really big movies.
Cold Mountain. Yeah,
they were both really chilly.
Renee Zellweger having a sour face.
Yep. Oh yeah, she does have a sour face. The Company, Confidence, The Cooler, The Core, The Cradle to the Grave, where DMX displayed his martial arts ability in backflipping off of walls and Timberlands.
Hell yeah, with Jet Li. Did you like it?
When I was a kid, I liked it. I thought it was cool.
There you go.
But then I watch it now, and I'm like, this is ridiculous. Yeah. And then, Dark Blue? Wait a minute.
I swear this was in last week's, wasn't it?
Yeah.
We'll look into that. But no, I'm... Like, no, this I'm isn't deja sure. vu.
No, we literally talked about years. Dark Blue the other day. Because
I said something directly.
Yeah, because I said I was like, my friend used to go sneak it out of his parents' room.
Yes. We could email the webmaster and tell them they need to get their house in order.
Yeah, I don't know if that was actually from that year.
Yeah.
Who knows? Maybe it was from this year and it wasn't from the other year.
Maybe the years are meaningless. Darkness Falls, The Devil's Love. Dickie Roberts.
Ooh, I see a good one.
The Divorce, Down with Love, Dreamcatcher. It's pretty good. That's the Stephen King book, I believe, right?
It is. Yep. Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize Timothy Olyphant was in that. Damian Lewis is great. I mean, he's got a great cast. Morgan Freeman, Tom Jane, Jason Lee, Damian Lewis. Damian Lewis, if you don't know who he is, if you're Homeland or Billions. Freaking Bander Brothers. He was like one of the main characters. I'm a big fan of his.
Tom Sizemore.
Yeah.
R.I.P. Donnie Wahlberg.
Yeah, man. All Catching Dreams Out in the Snow.
Yep.
Let's see. Dumb and Dumberer.
Dumb and Dumberer.
Oh, so this is that kind of prequel that didn't feature any Jim Carrey or Jeff Daniels. But the guy who plays Jim Carrey ended up being on either one of those CSI, one of those CBS crime shows. Yeah, I don't remember which one, but he's like a regular on there. That's just interesting. Duplex. No, just found Elephant. Gus Van Zandt film. I feel like I should know that, but... Oh, Elf. My goodness. This is going to have to be a pick. So this... Elf. Elf has to be one of the most recent Christmas movies that I feel like is earned a status as a classic. Like, is a timeless classic. Like, I feel like Elf is... It's almost like a Christmas tradition. Like,
yeah,
you should watch it at least once every Christmas. And yeah, it's so, you know, cute and funny and whatever, but still, like, still funny enough. And, yeah, I can't wait to watch it with my daughter because it's, like, something you can feel... It's just so good.
Yeah, it is a really good movie. I do really enjoy Elf. It was all good all around, you know. What else we got over that?
We got
Evil Alien Conquers? Carnivores? What the fuck? I can't even read from here.
Do you have... Is glasses. Your vision really that bad?
No, yeah, I can't see what that is.
Conquerors.
Conquerors, okay.
I didn't know your vision was that bad.
It's not... I don't know. It's just for whatever reason it is now.
Oh. You get it because you're maximizing existence.
Dang.
Let's see. Festival Expect Fighting Temptations. Final Destination 2, Finding Nemo. So that was a pretty popular movie for the kids. I never actually saw it, but really? Yeah, it's one.
Yeah, it's a good movie.
I'm sure I'll watch it with the daughter when she gets older. That'd be a good
one. Yeah, it's a good movie. I like the turtles. I think were the best part about that movie.
My mom loves turtles.
Yeah, I like turtles.
Turtle. So you got that Fog of War, Freaky Friday. Oh, Freddy versus Jason.
Oh, yeah.
That's you.
I didn't... Yeah. It's not necessarily... I am a horror kind of guy, but it wasn't really... It wasn't really my speed, if I'm being honest.
Yeah. I mean, I literally milked that franchise. What's the one with the goat out of space? Is that one?
Wait.
There's like a Jason in space, isn't there?
Yeah. No, I know.
That's so absurd. I mean, movies can be absurd, but that's... Man, it's funny.
Yeah, talk about... I mean, he went from being on, like, a campground in a lake, Camp Crystal Lake,
to all the way to an ISS or something.
Like, come on, that's stupid.
I actually kind of want to watch it now. Jiggly. Ooh, terrible. Yeah, that was a razzie.
I didn't watch any of that.
Gods and Generals. Good boy. Ooh, Gothica.
Gothica.
There's that a guy thing, Haunted Mansion, Head of State.
Hey, DJ.
Get my DJ.
Holes with Shia LaBeouf.
I think a lot of people like this. I never saw it.
Yeah, I didn't. I saw it. I wasn't necessarily. I thought it was okay. It wasn't
bad. It was like kids.
A bunch of yellow spotted lizard bullshit.
The I guess like the kind of concepts and high level things.
Yeah,
they're kind of interesting for kids.
It really was. It wasn't bad. I can't totally hate on it.
It was creative enough, and different enough to be like, wow, okay, I can appreciate that.
Let's see, Honey, Hope Springs, House of a Thousand Corpses. I'd say like it's a up boy there.
Rob Zombie.
I think that House of a Thousand Corpses has a place. It obviously has a place in like horror movies because of, you know, there wasn't really many other films out there like it. It was fairly original, in my opinion.
I never saw it, so what was original about it?
Oh, gosh. Just kind of the whole concept of the thing. Like,
so it's a house with a bunch of dead bodies in
it? No, it wasn't necessarily that. It's more or less, like, if I remember correctly, it was like a family of people like that are almost like a Manson-type family.
Okay.
In the house they live in, you know, it's like they would just murder like strangers. So I was saying that it's like, you know, yeah, there were dead bodies in it, but I mean, it was interesting. But I think it has a place in horror movie.
I'll trust you because you're
especially in modern in modern horror movie. What's it called? House of a Thousand Corpses has a place.
Okay, all right, interesting. House of the Dead, How to Deal. There's a guy in 10 days. Ooh, the Hulk, the Ang Lee.
The Eric Bana. Yeah, I like this one.
It's definitely different. It's definitely Ang Lee. And it's cool. Ang Lee, the director, he's did like with Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. I guess that was like the big thing, I believe. But so it's definitely like a unique approach to it that it gets pretty out there for it, really. But.
I'm seeing some, I'm sorry to interrupt, but no, I'm seeing some, what would they call it, incongruity?
Okay, just keep working down. So I got You understand what I'm doing on it and imagining in the cut?
Identity. We've talked about this before.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
I think this might have been frailty.
Identity has been John Cusack. We've talked about this.
No, but I feel like there's a movie where we mentioned one and made us think of the other. I don't know. We'll have to check, because I feel like there was one where it was like frailty or something where one of us thought identity, but then we realized, oh, it wasn't, but then we said it was a good movie.
I think we've seen it. Okay, either way.
Either way, yeah, we'll figure it out.
I feel like we're seeing some...
Some media, the webmaster, the in-laws,
discrepancies,
intolerable cruelty, yeah, the runs of the family, the Italian job, this silly little heist movie, Jeepers Creepers 2, not near as good as the first one.
Yeah, the first one was... Yeah.
That one's up there.
Ooh.
Kangaroo Jack. Oh, nope, I know. It's definitely Kill Bill Volume 1. Yes, please. I'm not like a die-hard fan, but I do personally feel like every movie that Quentin Tarantino puts out is a very high quality, and that it's, you know, obviously a director who's got a very distinct style and vision, and I feel like he's so confident in doing it. You know, you might be on board, you might not be. But it's... I don't know. Whether you like his movies or not, I feel like he's like one of the best, most consistent directors of, you know, uniquely engaging, you know, movies.
Yeah, and I can't stuff disagree like that. With that at all, honestly.
And the fact that it was a... Kill Bill 1 and 2, that... Uma Thurman really should have been nominated for an Oscar for Best Actress on that.
Oh, yeah.
It was almost like it... Yeah, it's such a good movie. I'm going to have to go back and watch those.
And then, yeah, there's also another one, another good one, in my opinion. I don't know if you ever saw
Last Samurai.
Last Samurai. Did you see that?
Man, it's one that I actually haven't.
You haven't seen The Last Samurai?
And yeah, I just always think of the Chappelle joke.
I know. Like, yeah, I got Rooney? An idea for a movie. Here. Tom Hanks.
The Last Brother on Earth.
Yeah, starring Tom Hanks. Yeah, that would be... No, but The Last Samurai really is a good movie.
It looked good.
I thoroughly enjoyed it.
It did look good. Movie. So we got League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. That was also remember a good this.
Movie. Did you like that one? I liked it.
No, I thought it was pretty bad even back then. Legally Blonde 2, The Life of David Gale.
Oh. That was an interesting one.
Yeah.
Life of David Gale. That was like a...
He was like a death row or something like that.
Yeah, for some...
Kevin Spacey, R.I.P. Let's see.
Yeah, whatever happened to that guy, right?
Right. The Lizzie McGuire movie, that's you.
Yeah, big
Looney
fan
Tunes,
of
back in action, Lord of the Rings, like Return of the King.
Hilary Duff.
Hayley Duff, her sister. I don't know. They're both.
Dude, Hilary Duff is looking good these days.
Yeah. I think I've seen her on some show, and she
is looking good.
She definitely did mature into a fine young woman.
Yes, she did.
And I wouldn't have predicted it to go that way.
No, right? Yeah, you wouldn't have, but.
Hey, this is.
Let me tell you.
Weird as that sounds, it's just an honest assessment. Lost in Translation. Oh, that's Sofia Coppola. Francis Ford Coppola's daughter. Yeah, this had a lot of indie appeal.
Ooh.
A little too cool indie for me.
Malibu's Most Wanted. Malibu. You ever see that?
With Jamie Kennedy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love that movie. That movie was
Did
funny,
you like
man.
The Jamie Kennedy Experiment?
That was a funny show. I didn't mind it.
That's funny.
It was funny, but I'm telling you that Malibu's Most Wanted was a Don't Do It Bloodbath.
Man, if I've seen it, it's been a long time.
Oh, it was a funny movie. Ooh, okay, that's another good one.
Master and Commander?
No.
Matt Stickman?
Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned that on something else.
Chris mentioned it when we brought up Nicolas Cage.
There you go. Oh, the Matrix Reloaded and Revolutions came out that year. Maybe one released at the big. I wish they had the dates they released. That's very rare that they. I mean, I can see it. But to have those both come out in the same year?
Let me look that up real quick.
Yeah, The Matrix Reloaded and The Matrix Revolutions. Okay. I'm coming across a lot of findings that are making me question the integrity of this list.
Yeah, I know. So which ones are in question? The Matrix
Reloaded? Matrix Reloaded and The Matrix Revolutions. Just see when those came out.
Matrix Reloaded was 03.
Again?
Matrix Revolutions was 03.
So they must have been spaced out. Like, maybe the beginning of the year and end of the year?
Release date for Revolution was October 27th, 2003. And
that was the third one.
Matrix. Reloaded. Looks like it came out in May 15th. Wow. 2003.
That's a rarity.
Yeah. So you did have both of that is honestly kind of rare. And I would not have really thought of that.
No.
But again, yep,
Matt's good. And the first Matrix would handedly be on here. They were still enjoyable, but I feel like they got worse and worse. But they're still really solid sci-fi action. So keep going. A Mighty Wind. This is one I was trying to say about the guy who does fake documentaries with like Spinal Tap and stuff.
Okay.
So it's like a mockumentary about this, like. I don't know if they're like almost like Amish type traveling band, like family band. I don't know. It's really funny. Like it's really funny. See, Milwaukee Mister, The Missing Motor.
Yeah, The Missing. That's one I was about to look up. I'm like trying to. I feel like I've seen that one.
The Death Ring a Bell. Let me see. Excuse me.
I'm trying to look that up right now.
Tap your room.
The Missing.
So Mighty Wind is a back three eclectic, never quite famous folk band. That's what it was, making fun of folk music. It was it's pretty funny. So okay. Mona Lisa Smile.
The Missing, yeah, it was with okay.
Tom Jones, Tommy Lee.
Tommy Lee Jones, yeah. It's like an old Western type movie.
That's oh, Monster. This is where Charlize Theron got really ugly and was able to win Oscar.
She was the serial killer lady, right?
Yeah.
That's actually a wild story. Have you ever heard about that?
I mean, I've seen the movie. Like,
I watched a documentary on that lady. That was wild, dude. I've seen like the police interviews and stuff with her.
She's just nuts.
She was a wild character, dude. She just, like, the way she admitted to, like, killing dudes, like, because she was, I mean, it was crazy. Like, the way she just, like, straight up admitting to shooting men because they got too handsy with her. She's like, yeah, sure, he picked me up for sex, but then he got too handsy with me, and I dumped my .38 in him. Like, she was wild, dude. Yeah.
And like I said, Charlize Theron, when it's, like, getting ugly and fat for the role. It's like, Christian, a lot of these actors who do transformations. That was a rare female transformation.
It looked like she just ate at Waffle House and smoked cigarettes for that.
Seriously,
role.
Like
that's like all she did. She was like,
and it just shows you how far off being ugly and super hot are.
Yeah.
Anyone, it's a lot of being hot is literally just that being out of shape and having all your teeth and I don't know
exactly.
But yeah, that's funny. My boss's daughter.
Ooh, it's a good one right there.
Oh, Mystic River.
Yeah.
No, I feel like I've seen this one in one of these lists before, dude. I don't know. Maybe this is my first deja vu. National Lampoon presents Dorm Days, Gold Diggers. Oh, old school.
God, can't deny. Yeah.
Can't deny some of the memories and quotableness from that one. Definitely.
Yeah.
Once Upon a Time in Mexico. Oh, it was a sequel to El Mariachi.
Yeah. Oh, God. That was such a good one.
Yeah.
Robert Rodriguez, the Open Range.
That was
a cowboy movie, right?
Open. Oh man, Once Upon a Time in Mexico was so good.
It was.
Robert the Rodriguez. Order with Heath Ledger.
The Order. I don't remember.
Yeah, Out of Time, Denzel. That was a good one.
Party Monster. Oh yeah, I remember that.
Paycheck, Peter Pan, Phone Booth.
Phone Booth was a taut thriller. I just remember calling for it. I mean, I wouldn't be picked, but it was unique. It was literally like Colin Farrell gets stuck in a phone booth, basically the whole movie, like being held hostage. I don't know if it's like by a sniper or something, but like somebody's got him on the phone and he can't leave because they got like a shot on him, and they're like, I guess, trying to get him to expose how crappy of a person he's been or something. So it's like basically all takes place with him in this phone booth. And Joel Schumacher film, he's been hit or miss. I mean, it was a nice taut little thriller, but it, you know, I appreciated what it was able to pull off and still be interesting, but yeah. It'd be worth seeing just for that, but not like, oh, it's some
grumpy. Yeah, no, it is. It's a decent movie, but yeah, nothing crazy.
Yeah, because we also have to blame Joel Schumacher for some of the Batman movies, I believe.
Oh,
Batman and Robin.
Oh.
And Batman Forever, I think.
Oh, yeah, a lot of people
love Batman Forever was right, but Batman and Robin.
Yeah, those people that were not a big fan of those.
Yeah, that was the perfect days of Batman Forever, me and your brother.
Yeah,
back when you quote Jim Carrey. Jim Carrey was the biggest deal, man.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. After all the Ace Ventura's, the Mask.
He was our idol. So Piglet's big movie. Ooh, Pirates of the Caribbean movie came out
that year. Black Pearl, that was a good one.
Pretty big, huge movie.
That was a great movie.
Yeah, the Gore Verbinski, the director, he's another one of those, you know, you see his movies, they definitely got that. I don't know. It's like really kind of like life is a cartoon style to him. It's pretty cool.
Oh, dang. There we go. There's Radio. Radio.
For real?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah, I'm just putting it down.
Is he going full? Did he go full for that one?
No, I don't think. I think he did. He did, but he... But he did it in regards like to the character. Like if you
never go full.
But if you see the guy he was depicting.
Why is it called Radio? Is that what his name was?
Yeah, well, because the character was like he was touched. He was slow.
No. Touched by the angels.
And the guy like loved radios. He was fascinated with radios, so he always had a little radio on him. And so they just called him Radio. The guy didn't know his name.
He played football, right?
No, he was like a mascot. He kind of, not necessarily a mascot. He helped the coach out. It's like in the movie, it starts off with he's more or less getting picked on by other like football players at the school. Ed Harris is the coach of the football team. Comes over, sees what's happening.
So they're making fun of a clearly mentally challenged person.
Yeah, they were like picking on him, and then Ed Harris comes over and he's like, "Nah, fuck that," and then makes him stop, and then he like takes the kid home and he meets his mom, and his mom is like, you know, this is how he is, like, you know, that's, there's nothing wrong with him. His mom's like, no, there's nothing wrong with my boy,
whatever. He always loved his radio,
and so they end up just calling
him. Always loving his radio, everywhere he go,
pretty much. But he just ended up like, that's why they called him Radio, is because he always had a little radio with him, and so that's where he got his little nickname. But it was a cool. He was a real person. Radio was a real person.
That's wonderful.
It was based on a real. It was based on an actual person.
A real IRL mentee talented person that liked radios.
You haven't seen the movie?
No, I have no desire to see it.
You should. You should check it out.
I've listened to a lot of what you say, but that's one that's not going to happen. The Real Cancun. The Recruit. The Room. Oh my gosh, this is like classic, one of the worst like, you're familiar with this, right? The Room. Like, this is the one with the freaking James Franco made a movie about it, The Disaster Artist.
Oh yeah,
it's about
Tommy White.
The movie that
the worst movie. Yes, because then I know I've seen.
He's like, like that.
It's ridiculous.
We're gonna have to put.
Yeah, I'd rather watch Radio than that.
But it's like one of those things that's so bad that it's hilarious.
It's so bad that radio's still better.
Serious when he was doing it, but then I think he just really leaned into as though it was on purpose, but it is so bad.
No, it's awful.
So I'm going to have to pull up a clip for so people to see exactly what we're talking about.
No, it's really quite awful. But it got famous for being like...
How bad it is.
Yeah, it got famous for being so
like
bad.
Like midnight showing type thing. Like I said, James Franco made the movie called The Disaster Artist. Really about it.
No, you're absolutely right. I watched that.
So I got Runaway Jury, The Rundown. Oh, that was a remake, wasn't it?
The Rundown? Yeah. It might have been.
If not, it was entertaining. You know, Rock, Sean William Scott, Christopher Walken. I think this might be one where Christopher Walken agreed to do it, only if he could, like, ad-lib his lines the whole time or something ridiculous. To where, like, just remember something like that. This would be funny. So, Scary Movie 2. That's you. School of Rock. That was really good. Seabiscuit's Secondhand Lines. Shanghai Nights. Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas. Sky Blue, Something Has Gotta Give. Spy Kids 2. The Station Agent. Stuck on You. Oh, man. This is the Fairley Brothers movie about the conjoined twins.
Yep, with Matt Damon. Yeah.
It's the fact that movie was made. Fairley Brothers, they had some classics. It's just so ridiculous. It's hard not to be like... Obviously, I don't think they could make that today, because it's like...
Oh, no, yeah, you couldn't have.
And the one's like Greg Kinnear's like a real good actor and performer, and it's just...
It was ridiculous. You couldn't have... Yeah, you couldn't have made that today.
Commitment to the bit, though, I gotta give him... Turning into Tears of the Sun. It was an Anton Fuqua movie. Oh,
my gosh.
Yeah, that was did Training Day. Pretty good. Terminator 2, 3, Rise of the Machines. The ending for that was good. That ending of that one was actually
made the movie okay. There is so many good movies that came out this year.
Testosterone, Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake. 13. I think this was controversial indie film. Girl's Life Timeline.
Was that you trying to say testosterone?
Testosterone. 2 Days. Uncle 9. Under the Tuscan Sun. Underworld. Uptown Girls.
She be living in an uptown world.
V-Day. Vagina Day. Until the violence stops. Veronica Guerin. View from the Top. What a Girl Wants.
What a Girl Wants.
I'll let you read some of these.
What a Girl Needs.
Can you
When Eagles Strike?
There we go. That's good.
Okay. You say you want me to read some song? Willard, Wonderland, Wrong Turn, X-Men 2, or X2, X-Men United.
Let's see. Yep.
The Yes Men.
Okay. We're almost at the end.
The Young Black Stallion. That's what they call my homeboy.
Yeah?
Yeah, my homeboy George, shout out. They call him the Young Black Stallion.
You think why is that?
I don't know, man. Maybe, I don't know. That's what the ladies call him.
He loves horses.
Maybe.
And then here's the end.
0 Day. Fucking zero. Okay, so I've got some movies here that I'm going to pick, and I think that all of the picks I have right here are the movies that you would end up picking. So I'm going to let you go first so that I can just cross out. Because I think I have all the movies right here that you would pick. Because I have your movie taste and better. I think my movie taste is a little better. I've seen a lot of movies you haven't seen. You know what I mean? The movies that I feel like you have seen that I haven't seen. It makes sense that I haven't seen the movies that you've seen. Because it's like, who the fuck else has seen those movies? You know what I mean?
Yeah, that makes sense.
But the movies that I've seen, it's like, yeah, you should see those movies. Oh, the
mainstream shit?
Movies. Yeah, exactly. Mm. Oh, yeah. Go ahead, talk down on me with my mainstream
shit. No, mainstream
shit.
Can be good.
No, yeah, it can be. I'm not watching dudes get jerked off.
No, it was fellatio.
Oh, okay.
And it was unsimulated fellatio.
All right, well, I'm not watching unsimulated.
Well, you're missing out.
I'm watching a mentally challenged guy that likes radios. Big deal.
All right, so...
Okay, I already got the list right here. Keep going.
So Elf is going to have to be one.
Elf and Kill Bill are your picks.
Yes, Elf and Kill Bill.
Is that right?
Yep.
I'm not trying to put words in your mouth.
Those are good. Those are them. So what are your two first picks? And then we'll do a couple honorable mentions since we're a little
short-staffed
tonight.
Yeah, I was going to say I have, because I definitely have a few.
Okay, then name them all. I trust since you have better taste and all that.
Since we've established how much better my taste is.
These wings, so just tell me, tell me what I missed.
Yeah, so I'm going to tell you what you missed, and since my taste is so much better. And it's not that you missed it, it's that the ones that I was writing down were the ones that you were also reacting to, and you also enjoyed it. It was just, I saw it coming.
Let's get to it, son.
So, Bad Santa. I mean,
it's got to be.
You've got to put Bad Santa in there. I guess I should do this. I'll go with, Bad Santa is a pick of mine. And then the other pick would have to be on the total opposite end of the spectrum.
Last Samurai.
No, it would be actually Big Fish.
Dude.
I love Big Fish. It's such unique. A good story because it's like the way.
Movie magic.
Well, not only that, but yeah, it's like whenever he finds that little town, like on his journey in the middle of like nowhere, it's almost like a parallel universe where he meets like the poet.
Yeah.
I mean, it's such a good movie. So
it's like dreams come true of all that type of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. So,
and like I said, my friend Nathan is just, he liked it, and it so well defined his character, I feel like. Just him really like. Now, being all that much into movies, but really liking that sort of thing.
Yeah, and I thought that was a great movie. So shout out to my sister; she was the one that got me on that. And then the other ones that I have to like, I think have to go. They can't go without mentioning. I feel like Tears of the Sun for an action movie. Yeah. I think was a fantastic movie.
You said the Antoine Fuqua Training Day.
Yep. I also would have to say again for another movie that can't go without mentioning that came out of that year that was great is Mystic River. It's all over the spectrum of like emotions, like Tears of the Sun versus Mystic River and Bad Santa, Big Fish, Kill Bill.
Good point.
And then again, another one we mentioned was Dreamcatcher
with Stephen King.
That was also a really good one.
It was. It's like one. I feel like a lot of his works are poorly adapted.
Yeah,
but that one is like one of the rare ones that I feel like they did decent.
And I would have to agree with the way you just said that. Like a lot of his works being poorly adapted, like that was a good way of putting it. Like,
it's just a sad truth.
No, it is, and I wouldn't have been able to put it that way. And then after Mystic River, another one that I think that has to be mentioned in there, that shout out to Chris, he was the one that mentioned this to me and made me watch it.
Kangaroo Jack.
Matchstick Men.
Sam Rockwell, that if you didn't appreciate him, that movie should help you appreciate its greatness.
Right. I really liked the movie Matchstick Men. Such a great movie. And then I'm coming down to my last two here of honorable mentions that I feel like have to go talk about. Secondhand Lions.
Okay, tell me about that one.
Have you never seen it? It's got Michael Caine, I believe, and Ed Harris. Or no, not Ed Harris. God, what's his name?
Where are they lions? They got him a secondhand store.
What's the other guy? Adam Duvall, Robert Duvall, and Michael Caine, and Haley Joel Osment.
That's our boy.
And yep. And it's more or less Haley Joel Osment has like a shit mother that dumps him on his two uncles, and she pretty much like looks at it like her son is hindering her life, and so she wants to like leave him and go out and find some man that'll marry her. So she dumps him on his two uncles, and it turns out that his uncles at Robert Duvall and Michael Caine are, you know, like they had their own kind of wild life in the past, and it turns out that they're kind of rich and loaded, and it's such a good movie. It goes all over the place. He starts ending up like to
which
where
movie
they,
are we talking about again?
Secondhand Lions.
Okay.
So it gets to a point where they end up like Haley Joel Osment finds out they have this money, and he's like, why don't y'all spend it? Like, do something with it. So then he ends up buying a fucking lion.
So they're an old gay couple?
They buy a lion. No, they're like brothers.
Huh.
But they're just like brothers that live together on this property.
Are they singing and the color?
No. Oh, I see. So Secondhand Lions, dude, I'm telling you, you should really you
I'm
should
sure
check it out. It
sounds
movie.
Heartwarming.
And then Old School.
Oh, yeah.
I think, is the other one that I would have to go that has to be mentioned would be Old School.
I agree.
To come out of 2003.
I think you did a great job.
I think those are the best ones. So Matt's picks are Kill Bill and Elf. Mine are Bad Santa and Big Fish. Honorable mentions, Secondhand Lions, Old School, Matchstick Man, Mystic River, Dreamcatcher, and Tears of the Sun.
Look at that.
And that is the movies for 2003 that are worth a S.
That is very true.
That you should go check out.
Yeah, out of all those, honestly, I mean,
yeah, there's probably some wrong, more in there that are going to be good, but
no, but you know, I think we got the cream of the crop.
Yeah, you've got an array of emotions in all those movies that I think will do the job.
I agree. Have yourself
a little bit of mystery, a little bit of comedy, some drama, a little love.
Yeah,
but everything in there.
Some radio act. Somebody loves radio. Oh, well,
see, I didn't mention radio. I had it marked down there, but I didn't mention radio.
I'm glad. I'm glad.
Even though you're criticizing movies you haven't seen, but it's okay.
That's my right.
It is. It is, I suppose. It is.
It's kind of like, you know, I didn't need to see.
Say it.
I didn't need to see to know.
You say it. You didn't need to see what?
The Mothman.
Okay. But you know what, though? He sees you.
You know, we'll take a break, but you showed me something that's eerily connected to a Mothman.
That is true.
It's tragic, but we got to talk about it. So we'll be right back. I've slept for 2 days. I've bathed in nothing but sweat.
Back and we're back, and yeah, you were just mentioning something about that was eerily similar to the Mothman.
Sort. Yeah, kind of creepy.
Yeah, sort of. But it's also, aside from the, you know, the joking in a sense tying the Mothman thing to something that just happened in the movie or in the legend of the Mothman, he was spotted on top of a bridge that ended up collapsing, and there was something that recently happened that I woke up and saw on my phone the other day that unfortunately it looks like again. It looks like a giant shipping container hit a bridge in Baltimore. I didn't even know what happened at first. I just saw something about bridge collapse, and then I started watching videos, and I just recently showed it to Matt. He had no idea this happened,
I didn't,
which I find incredible that you had no idea.
I'm so tuned out of
I just news. Feel like it's if bad. If you would have it somehow would have popped up on something, I would have thought for sure.
I'm not around anyone that's watching the news. That's
crazy.
Like,
yeah, well, I don't watch the news either.
Yeah, that's but you wild. Probably saw your mom or dad or someone mention.
No, it popped up on my phone or something. Like, that's where I saw. It was like, oh, Google, see,
my
feed.
I don't even get. They know me too well.
That's what
they
I meant. Like, I saw like on a Google feed or something. Like, yeah, to get on Google. But either way, long and short of it is that unfortunately it looks like a shipping. A shipping crate, carrier, container, boat, ferry boat, would you call it? Ended up hitting a bridge in Baltimore. I mean, I'm sure everybody that's listening to this is like, shit, we heard about this. But either way, that's what he's mentioning.
I literally just heard it. Tonight, like right before Mike, you showed me, I'm like, what the footage of that is just
it's a little wild. It looks like, as far as we can see from the footage that you can go off of, is that this boat, it looks like it lost power and then regained power and then lost power again, and then once it regained it tried to put in, like, go full thrust in reverse to try and get away from the bridge. But at that point, from what I understand, they described what happened is what's called like rudder walk.
This is going to be a process, right?
And rudder walk is whichever way the big propeller is spinning, if it's spinning clockwise or counterclockwise. If you go to reverse, your boat is going to shift, is going to move in the direction that rudder is spinning. It's like, so what happens is it just ends up walking the boat. So they're saying that what happened is whenever they technically, it's like they did everything, they were reacting the way they should have, but by putting it in reverse and doing that, it rudder walked it straight into the bridge, from what I've gathered based on the things I've heard. Either way,
tragic.
Either way, it's incredibly tragic. One, I guess, if you could say a good thing about it, is it happened.
The Mothman died in the cloud.
No, he's eternal. Mothman can never die. The one good thing that I guess you could have said, if there is a good thing about it that happened, is the fact that it was at like 1:30 in the morning, so it wasn't like during rush hour where there was a bunch of families.
It helped. There was just drunks driving across the bridge recklessly.
No, unfortunately, you would think, but you would hope that, but
you would hope that.
You would hope that it would have just been that, but it was...
So you've never been drunk and made a mistake driving?
I'm not saying... Yeah, no,
I just painted a picture and labeled them worthy of dying, and you just went and agreed with it.
I'm saying that it was actually like construction workers.
So you
want to
execute drunk people?
No, I don't. I think that sounds like what certain people of a political standing make. It's a straw man argument, I believe is what that's called.
Yeah, I'm about to straw you a man. So yeah, that was very argument. That was very tragic.
But yeah, so what? There was actually construction workers, unfortunately, that were on that bridge that collapsed, and they're still looking for, I think, four of them at least.
Dang.
So like I said, if there is a good thing that. If it could have happened in a good circumstance, I guess it happened so late at night to where there wasn't that much traffic. It wasn't peak hour, and there wasn't a bunch of people just stuck sitting there. That could have been awful.
Oh, yeah.
My heart goes out to anybody that just is so crazy, because it's like it's something that you would never expect should even happen.
It's like a Hollywood movie. Like, you can't believe it's real.
Yeah, you understand that there's a chance of somebody getting, your loved one getting in a car accident or something like that happening. But you wouldn't.
Bridge collapsing.
Yeah, you wouldn't expect that. It's like, wait, you're telling me that my loved one didn't come home because boat hit the bridge?
Like, how many boats
collapsed?
Have gone under there since it's been made? Like,
that's
what I'm saying. It's like, okay, whatever the odds are, if 1 in 100,000 or I don't know. So I guess it finally happened. But naturally, the human mind can't wonder if there was some intentional sabotage on the part of someone. Just because it's quite strange the way it just loses power at that time, you know?
Yeah, well, so the thing I'll say on the whole losing power thing and that, and on the, you know, not saying conspiracy, but like the thing of like sabotage, is that also too...
Beastie
Boys know.
Song is better than
I really
that.
Don't know, like, about that. But, for
sabotage.
Instance, there was years ago that there was a helicopter that went down in New York.
Yeah, Kobe Bryant died in it, right?
No, there was actually two guys that were on it, and I knew both of them. They were from Dallas. They were in New York, and they were on a helicopter doing, like, a tour of the city, and the helicopter had a malfunction, and they died.
How
and,
did you know these guys?
They went to school with my friends here in Dallas at
really?
Bishop Lynch. Yeah. And so they died. They were on this helicopter doing a tour, just friends going to see each other. And
was
one of
a silver
them lived
lining
in New
for
York.
This one again?
It's not a silver lining at all. I'm describing.
Okay, so
I'm
were,
trying to
they
give
were
you
jerks.
Context. I'm trying to give you a context of to what happened with this boat, possibly, because you were saying sabotage. So this helicopter that these guys were on that crashed, the reason it crashed is because somebody else that was on it had a photography bag, and the strap for the bag got caught on the fuel shutoff, and it shut
serious?
The fuel off, and the fucking helicopter crashed. So that's what I'm saying.
Dang,
you
so
could
you
choose
never,
to look at it
yeah.
and say that it's a conspiracy. Well, maybe somebody sabotaged
freak
the helicopter.
Yeah. Freak thing
or maybe
happened.
Some guy leaned back on a fucking power switch and cut the thing off, and they're like, what's going on? And then at that point, you have to go into certain overrides on the ship. And it's you're swinging
there's a lot of variables
the horse
that are,
is already
I have
bolted.
No idea what they are so
exactly and it's like so you could choose to look at it as people could look at it as sabotage and things like that or again
yeah,
it's like Murphy's
what would
law
be the,
anything
would,
that can go wrong
exactly.
will go wrong
yeah who would be gaining from it you know so you just wonder what the shit it's just so crazy
oh yeah I don't even know I wouldn't even know enough of about any yeah. what's gained or to what's to be gained or lost by like
human
quote,
dignity.
An attack on that area. But I mean, either way, I don't know anything about that. I just know that the boat, unfortunately, struck one of the pillars and the bridge came down. And they're unfortunately looking for some poor souls still.
God, please be with them. So moving on to more exciting news.
What's that?
I was under the impression that nobody had anything else to say.
Oh, that was the exciting news?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. I have a pug behind me that... I think you said Potato wanted to say something, right?
Yeah, she was sounding fairly talkative earlier.
Maybe you need to hold her and see. Say that again, Potato.
She just laid her face on the mic. She just laid her
face against the mic. Potato, what are you...
We're trying to give her mic time to talk, and she just laid her head on the microphone.
And literally closed her eyes.
Bro, this pug is broken. We're trying to give you your camera time, girl.
Hey, Mikey, bring out the best. Wait, there is a little bit. Potato. There we go. Say it. Okay. And what else? Well, he touched it. Potato, that's a serious allegation.
What else?
Yeah, what else? All right, yawn. You can take a yawn. That's okay. There's some ASMR right there.
What do you think about that, girl? You want to go home with me?
Potato, don't listen to him. Don't listen to that bad man.
You want to go home with me? Oh.
Sweet pug. Sweet pug.
So the pug didn't have much to say.
But she did say a little bit.
Yeah, and I guess and a little we don't bit have much to say either.
No, it's, you know, we're trying to branch out a little bit of our creative endeavors. As you see the intro, we had wanted to be a little more creative, almost, you know, tell a little mini story there. So, yeah, be expecting more content, ancillary to the podcast that might connect to it in some way or another. But yeah, we're looking to expand.
Yeah, absolutely.
What we're doing, you know, just we've got different passions. We'll talk about different things, and but yeah, so we want to just have fun with you guys, and you know.
Yeah, so like Matt was saying, gonna have a little. Hope you guys enjoy the little intro we're put together. Matthew is put together with his creativity and his technical skills.
Yeah, I mean,
getting to flex some of his directing ability. But yeah, I mean, there's definitely gonna be some. We're gonna do some stuff in the future just to be a little more creative and try and just just do stuff.
We could be auditioning actresses that are willing to perform unsimulated fellatio. Which if we'll have a pretty bold intro where it's Mikey. I know how, you know how I wanted to see you push your acting skills. I want
to
see.
I didn't know. Like, I thought you meant you wanted me to be able to cry on camera.
No, you're crying when it happens. It's a very emotionally trying.
Oh God.
It's a cry job.
It's crazy that it seems like the first episode of season 3 might be our last episode.
Well, it might be if we can find an actress to
Oh goodness.
We can shoot that scene right tonight, so just, worst case, we hire an escort.
Oh God! Well, I mean, it wouldn't be too hard right now in Dallas with the current state of prostitution.
Is prostitution on the rise in Dallas?
Oh, it's yeah, it's absolutely. It's been on the rise. They really. It's all. It's.
I mean,
hands off.
It is
they don't care.
The oldest profession.
Don't park the wrong way.
You understand
in Dallas,
that, right?
Yeah, absolutely. What's not to understand that's the oldest profession?
This is funny. I guess this is one of those things whenever I was a little kid, and I'd hear it and not think about it, but then you start to talk about it, it's like, oh yeah, arguably it could be the oldest profession.
Oh, there's it definitely is. But yeah, I mean, it's not hard to find out there on Harry Hines. I'm not saying it's,
I know Harry Hines is a part of Dallas that's my whole life been stereotypically associated with, you know, streetwalkers and, you know, very kind of run down, dingy, crime-ridden places, and it's just gonna be that way forever, I guess.
No, well, that's the thing. It's like for a little bit, so it had a reputation years ago. Like you said, when you were a kid, it always had a certain reputation. But
like
then once you got a little bit older, it kind of got better.
Yeah.
So for the past, I'd say maybe, you know, you could say, oh God, it's like there was a time from, I'd say, probably about 15-20 years where it was somewhat okay. It's like that wasn't really as open, but now, I mean, boy, it is out there.
Now the hoe's working it.
It is out there and it is open. It is not, it's more or less, I guess,
how you're looking for a good time,
sir. That's like Deep Ellum too. Deep Ellum's kind of getting back to what Deep Ellum used to be in
You drive by, I mean, it's crazy how much they've developed and built up, but for it still to have like random crime elements.
Oh, dude, the crime down there is pretty terrible.
It's like, and that's, but it that's looks the thing. Really it nice. To, They've, it, it's crazy for the client, like the customer base that's going out there now, but it's still so close to crime that.
Oh, it's very close, and they don't like. I mean, that's the thing is it's getting back to how it was kind of like in the 80s and 90s in Deep Ellum, where it was like Deep Ellum was bikers and punks, and they would fight each other. And
yeah.
Now it's, you know, it's like it. When I was
now it's like liquor, hipsters get.
That's how it was when I was delivering liquor there at Specs when I was like 21.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was like. Shit, 10, 11 years ago. Yeah. So, you know, now, like, then it was fine. You didn't have any problems on Elm Street or whatever, because I used to go out there all the time.
Yeah.
But then now, and in the past, you know, 4, 5, 6 years, I mean, it's gotten kind of interesting. There's been, like,
stay strapped when you go.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And at that rate, it's like, you might as well just not go.
Yeah. Between dealing with parking and that.
Just go to the best bar in Dallas, Milo Butterfingers.
You know, that's my that spot. Is a staple. That place.
Boy, that is my spot.
Is a long-standing.
You know what? Don't go there, because that's where I go. Leave me alone.
Hey, man, I used to go there. I used to do darts there every week. We had a weekly tournament, man.
Oh, I'd be on those pool tables.
Oh, yeah.
I was a force to be reckoned with on the pool tables.
But you knew whenever, like, me and your brother, we'd do the darts with Jeff and them.
I used to go meet y'all over there after
Very
Sistema.
Very obsessed with darts.
I used to drive down there after Sistema and meet y'all there.
Oh, good old.
Whenever y'all would dart around.
Yep, I had to put away the old dart board for the baby room. But
yeah, right. Yeah, it's not good having the dart board above the crib.
Yeah, it's not advised.
It's not a good location for it.
It's just not a good look.
Yeah,
you want
a better location for it.
You know, it's people come in, it's like, oh, that's where you put your dartboard. Yeah, well, it's the only place I had.
It's like, well, I put like a
look,
thick, heavy
my
piece
daughter
of carpet
insisted
over the crib.
That I leave it there.
Yeah.
What am I gonna do? Tell her no?
Yeah, you know, like you can't have the dartboard above her bed like
exactly.
all the other kids.
Exactly. So she wanted left there, and she asked for. A few sets of darts. She asked for a lot of other sharp objects. And I'm just like, honey, whatever you want.
Yeah, you got to give these kids what you want nowadays.
Yeah, when they ask for something, you just give it to them. You don't question it. You don't think about if it's good for them or their development. You just give it to them. And then you say, I love you. And smack them on the booty a little bit. And then they're on their way.
Is that how it works?
And you've raised a well-functioning member of society.
Damn.
Yep, so...
So you want to get on a recommendation of the week?
You know, it's been a chill cruise, which is nice.
Yeah,
you
it's
know?
Been a nice little chill cruise.
It's been odd. We've had our couch guy here for so long. So when you came through the doors and he went there, it was almost like...
You're like, whoa.
Is this the same reality dimension that I was... In that,
thought
it,
you were in the virtual.
Did you cross over
you got,
at some
you got
point?
Stuck in the virtual boy,
dude. I'm telling you, man.
I think the virtual boy might have caused an issue in the universe.
Yeah, it caused a rift to where I don't think the Chris that is at your house is our Chris.
Oh,
I think that is Chris
from
another dimension.
I just
think that he's an alternate universe Chris that might have somehow got swapped with ours.
Okay,
so. It's just a Chris that has different life experiences. I don't know if he's got a best friend, Matthew, so maybe he didn't even remember
who I am. Should I give him some probing questions, you think, to figure this out?
You have to be very intelligent, because he might not even be aware that he got swapped to a new dimension.
Wow,
it could have just happened in his sleep. So that gives me this Rex, the show Constellation, all right, on Apple TV. I would have to say, for the most part,
the home for the best prestige sci-fi shows for the most part. Not that there aren't other great ones elsewhere, but it seems like every sci-fi show that they've released is pretty darn good. If not, you know, I mean, it's just all pretty good. So one that Constellation came out, it's kind of dabbles into what we're talking about there. It's like, except so it's like a returning astronaut coming home, and it deals with, you know, differing realities and this quantum entanglement and all that stuff. But it's pretty, it's pretty cool. So recommendations are gonna be to watch. There's gonna be Constellation, which is really good. There's a show called The Signal on Netflix that almost eerily has a similar plot, but it ends up being very different. For me, not near as good. Constellation's a lot more. There's a lot more thinking involved for me. And then my third final rec is Three Body Problem.
Yeah, you started me on that one last night.
It's so unfamiliar. I know that it was in development for a long time. It's a wildly creative and scientifically founded as much as it can be book, like the book's based on, but it's so the adaptation that Netflix has done, it's good. Like, it's good enough just because it's still just such an interesting, unique sci-fi story. It's like you see a lot of sci-fi storylines being repeated, you know, or you see, you know, a theme across a lot of movies. With this one has its own thing going on. It's about as unique of a story as I can think of in recent history. So it's really cool. And yes, so apparently there was like an actual Chinese version of the show made a couple of years ago because it's based on a Chinese author. But so the Netflix season, unless it does too terribly, like it is set up for, you know, there's like three books, so hopefully they get to do them all. But it's quite thought-provoking. It's in the Chinese version, it really gets into, like, it's probably way too uninteresting or scientific or for a lot of people, but it's, especially the Chinese version, but it, man, for me, it's just like my brain loves just chewing on all the theoretical physics, metaphysics, yeah. And just it's so
right up your alley.
Yeah, so those are, sorry, I know I kind of gave three, but just to check out those shows. So I'm trusting you to maybe bring something powerful and insightful, but if not, I can think of something else.
No, yeah, powerful and insightful. No, I don't know that. I don't know if it'll be powerful and insightful.
Just maximize existence is all I gotta do.
I think that I would just say, dude, spend some time with some loved ones, man. If it's your mom, your dad, whoever you have the access to spend time with, go ahead and do it. You know, it can be
so, like, good, if they can't be in jail,
a friend of yours. No, it could be what I mean by that is, if you don't say, because some people out there don't really have family members, but it's like the closest person you have that you can consider that's a family true. member. If you have a good friend of yours,
that's why sometimes I feel bad for player three.
The person you have the closest connection with, it's like, do the best you can to go out of your way and to just, you know, because see, that's the thing sometimes too, is you don't even have to go out of your way. Sometimes it's right there, but you just choose to get wrapped up in doing other things, get busy, and you want to, you know, you spend your week doing work and all of life and all the things you have to, the obligations you have to fulfill and stuff like that. And then you'd rather, you know, go spend your leisurely time doing something you want, in a sense, rather than just sitting around with, you know, a family member or something like that, or spending time with a loved one, things like that.
Yeah.
It's like, in a sense, you want to go do something that's your hobby. I want to go fish, or I want to go play a video game or whatnot. It's like,
you want to do something for you.
Exactly. You want to do something for you.
Think of just
putting someone else ahead of yourself at the bare bones of it.
Yeah, exactly. Because
at the end of the day, and unless you can tell they want to be alone, and even then,
yeah,
it could be like you just stand for a couple minutes, you read the room, and then you leave them on their own. But
yeah, but either way, my point is I would say just go out of your way, spend some time with a loved one, or you know,
yeah,
and a loved one doesn't have to just be somebody you're related to. It's
now it could be anyone. That's what I'm saying. Sometimes I feel bad our player three jokes.
Yeah.
Because I'll stop and think about it, and I don't know that they have anybody.
Yeah, right.
You know?
Yeah, you never know. And that's why, you know, you just have to. That's why also, too, expressing patience with people is important, too, you know, because you don't know. You might be the only person
I know
that somebody has to talk to. You might be
It's so easy to forget that. Everyone has a bunch of friends, you know?
You could be at work. Like, I've worked with dudes before where it's like, man, this guy's kind of just, it's like you're nice to him. Like, you never see him talking to anybody, and then you're nice to him, and then all of a sudden they just won't shut up, and they keep talking to you all the time. But then you realize, like,
it's like, dang,
there's probably nobody else they have to talk to. And it's
or no one that listens and gives them the time of day long enough. But
then, too, realizing that it's like, in their mind, they might look at you and be like, man, that guy Mike's really cool. Or that dude Matt's so cool.
That's totally what they think.
He lets me, like, man, that guy's cool, dude. Like, everybody else walks by me, but they care and they ask. He listens
to
me.
That's literally what it comes down to. It's like, wow, he actually gives me the time of day.
And you can hold a bigger impact in somebody's life just by doing that. Just by giving them a little bit of time can really have a big impact on people. And
and it can be trying, you know, like I said, player three can be tough, but like Mikey's saying, it's, you really don't know. A lot of people don't have anyone, and you don't realize it. And I take it for granted because of how blessed I am with how many friends I have and wonderful family. So I've almost got to remind myself every day that not everyone has that.
No.
And to take that into consideration in any human interaction at the end of the day, you know, not towards like weighing on you, but you know, if there's, like Mike is saying, it could be someone you work with, it could be someone who knows, but they're, you see them, they're
somebody part of your life regularly.
It could be a stranger.
Yeah.
But I'm saying it's like, even people in your life, you might not realize that they, you might be one of the only people they have, and you know, they might mean hardly anything to you, but you don't even know what your little niceness might mean to them, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. So. And so, you know, no. And with that being said, knowing your impact, give yourself a little pat on the back, because people might not say it, but it's like, I'll tell you, you're definitely more of an impact on people's lives than you give yourself credit for.
Oh yeah.
For instance, what I mean by that is, my mom the other day had found some like little letters that she had wrote just about like a random weekday that was going on. Mikey had his last baseball game today, and this and that, and this is what Mikey thought, and blah blah blah. And it was just weird for me.
What year?
Oh, I was like probably, you know, 10 years old or something, 9 or 10. And it was just crazy for me to think about that. It's like, man, like
she had it from that long.
They were just writing. They wrote, you know, my mom just wrote a letter to my aunt or grandmother and sent it to her. About Wednesday in my life, and it was like crazy to think about, to step back and to be like, damn, like I meant that much to somebody, that it's like they actually wrote a letter to another loved one to tell them what my life. Your parents
actually really love you.
What I cared about, you know, it's
like you got great parents.
Yeah, well, it's you know, aside from even just parents, it's like just realizing that, you know, you don't give yourself credit for certain things, and not realizing that it's like a lot of other people don't have those things, or they may never have them.
Yeah.
And you get caught up in
that comes back to appreciating those in your life, you know. It's kind of actually mirrors that perfectly, you know.
Exactly.
It's love, you know. It really comes down to loving your neighbor as yourself, right?
Yeah, for sure. But I think we've done our best to, you know, this week's been pretty taxing on me. I'm not gonna lie, I've been pretty tired. The work's been getting to me, so I haven't had a lot of time to do research for any kind of subjects or topics or anything like that with the podcast. And mostly this week has just been kind of like me getting to kind of spend time with Matt and us to just cut loose and just chill out. We haven't, when we've been hanging out over here the past 2 weekends I spent the night, it's just been hanging out and getting to chill. And
we
haven't necessarily done a whole lot of really putting our energy into just doing stuff for the podcast. It's like we've more or less just been kind of enjoying each other's company and living our lives. Just
having little sleepovers, man.
Yeah.
Mikey's got this amazing foldaway cot that he brings.
I
feel like everyone should have one of these things.
Yeah, right?
It's like, you know, you're cresting where, even though we've got extra beds and stuff, sometimes it can be awkward for, I don't know, but he's got this little collapsible, like, cot bed thing. I just remember last week when he came over with it, and it's kind of like a suitcase
yeah.
or something, but I'm like, all right, no, that's cool. But then you whip it out, it's like, damn, dude, all right, this is actually, pretty cool. Wherever you're hanging out, you have to sit there and think about, okay, I guess I'll go lay down in that room on that couch. It's like, oh, I'm sitting here, boom, there's a spot on
the right. Have it in the car, and if I need to sleep somewhere, I'm like, hey, man, can I bring my bed in?
Yeah, dude. There it is. Cool, man.
But yeah, no, so with that being said, I mean, we're trying to, we're doing our thing, but we're kicking off season three. I think we're kicking it off right with a little intro and stuff. And we're having some cool creativity things coming along.
Yeah, and you'll get a little, and you will have enjoyed that season one recap.
Yeah, the recap will be nice. Yeah.
So, exactly. Yeah, we'll get to, so this. Full disclosure, I'll put that together after we record this. So,
yeah,
but absolutely. It'll be at the beginning of the episode, so it'll be a surprise for you.
Yeah, but either way, thank you to everybody who continues to join us, mostly our friends. And speaking of friends, B Jones, we got to get you on here somehow.
Yeah, we'll do video at or some something. Point,
something, man. Got to get him because me and him been talking back and forth, audio messages and stuff like that.
I got him on the audio message. Yeah,
that dude is he's a wealth of ideas and concepts.
Oh yeah,
it's really just cool to talk to. He's just
Yep, he's one of my best friends.
Such a cool dude. But again, so. With that being said, thank y'all for joining us for the start of season three.
Yep.
And hope y'all have a good week. And keep it between the dishes. Be nice to each other. And we'll see y'all next Monday.
Much love. One love.